In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
My brothers and sisters, you are invited to share in our Mass together. It is God who invites us. How do we respond to that invitation? Joyfully or reluctantly? Do we come out of a sense of duty? Or because deep down, we are fully aware of what that invitation signifies. Let us then prepare ourselves to celebrate this Mass worthily by acknowledging our sins and asking Jesus to forgive us, to have mercy on us, and to give us the strength we need. Together we say, I confess, Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done, and in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us. May He forgive us our sins and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest,
and on earth peace to people of good will.
We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you. We give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, heavenly King, O God, Almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let us pray. May your grace, O Lord, we pray, at all times go before us and follow after, and make us always determined to carry out good works. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will provide for all peoples a feast of rich food and choice wines, juicy, rich food and pure choice wines. On this mountain, he will destroy the veil that veils all peoples, the web that is woven over all nations. He will destroy that forever. The Lord God will wipe away the tears from every face. The reproach of his people he will remove from the whole earth. For the Lord has spoken. On that day it will be said, Behold, our God, to whom we look to save us. This is the Lord for whom we look. Let us rejoice and be glad that he has saved us. For the hand of the Lord will rest on this mountain. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I shall live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life.
I shall live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life.
The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. In verdant pastures he gives me repose. Beside restful waters he leads me. He refreshes my soul.
I shall live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life.
He guides me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk in the dark valley, I fear no evil, for you are at my side, with your rod and your staff that give me courage.
I shall live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life.
You spread a table before me in the sight of my foes. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows.
I shall live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life.
Only goodness and kindness follow me all the days of my life. I shall dwell in the house of the Lord for the years to come.
I shall live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus again in reply spoke to the chief priests and the elders of the people in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be likened to a king who gave a wedding feast for his son. He dispatched his servants to summon the invited guests to the feast, but they refused to come. The second time, he sent other servants, saying, 'Tell those invited, behold, I prepare my banquet. My cows and fattened cattle are killed, and everything is ready. Come to the feast.' Some ignored the invitation and went away, one to his farm, another to his business. The rest laid hold of his servants, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged and sent his troops, destroyed those murderers, and burned their city. Then he said to his servants, 'The feast is ready, but those who were invited were not worthy to come. Go out therefore into the main roads and invite to the feast whomever you find.' The servants went out into the streets and gathered all they had found, bad and good alike, and the hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to meet the guests, he saw a man there not dressed in a wedding garment. The king said to him, 'My friend, how is it that you came here without a wedding garment?' But he was reduced to silence. Then the king said to his attendants, "Bind his hands and feet and cast him into the darkness outside, where there will be wailing and grinding of teeth. Many are invited, but few are chosen." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Aloha and a pleasant good afternoon to all of you.
Aloha.
After about 6 months, are you now comfortable wearing a mask? Yeah, it still takes time, and I guess that's just the reality that all of a sudden the situation is temporary, right? But the blessing could be I may forget my dentures and you will not see it. And I'm sure it's not just wearing the mask that all of a sudden is part of our routine, but there's something missing the past 6 months, right? All of a sudden, this past 6 months, because of the pandemic, we were advised not to have a social gathering. Imagine the graduation that took place, and yet the parents could not celebrate this wonderful occasion in the milestone of your child, right? Or even a funeral, a wedding, where in that wedding you are limited to having 10 guests, right? Or it could be as simple as what? The grandkids visiting their grandparents on a Sunday. We are missing the social interaction. We are missing that opportunity to come alive, that opportunity to be joyful. Isn't that what this whole celebration is? Baptism, graduation, birthdays, and whatever occasions, is this a what? Celebration of joyfulness. And at times, that's what we need to understand. What is the message of joy that we have, especially? One of the big celebrations in the Jewish time, even until today, would be the wedding feast. And that's the reason Jesus had a lot of parables regarding the wedding, right? If you recall the parable of the 10 virgins, where there were 10 virgins, and 5 have extra oil, and the other 5 did not, and all of a sudden the groom came, and they were not welcome in, right? Or even the first miracle of Jesus Christ is the wedding at Cana. Because the wedding celebration in their time could take days. And therefore, to run out of wine is an insult to your guests. And so, this is the reflection that we want to do today. That here is a king who invited his friends for this wonderful celebration, the wedding. Unfortunately, his friends opted out. His friends refused to come. His very own friends. Do we realize this? When we are to have big celebration, immediately what we remember will be our family members and friends. We want them to be part of this wonderful celebration. And that's what the king did. Unfortunately, his own friends did not. What was wrong? Why did they refuse the invitation? Why did they insult the king on the day of the wedding? For us to understand how the wedding took place during their time, you see, nowadays, if you are invited in the wedding, you will receive the invitation that says, the groom and the bride, right, will have this wonderful sacrament of matrimony. It's going to be at the Mary Star of the Sea on these dates and at this hour, right? Even this reception will follow at the Waikiki Hotel, right, at this hour. And then there's a PS, please be ready with your $15 for the valet parking, right? So we're clear, when we get an invitation, it's clear when will take place and the hour between the church as well as the reception. But that is not the case in the Jewish time. In the time of Jesus Christ, in terms of the wedding, first it is announced that there is going to be a wedding. But the when is not yet determined. So there's this first invitation extending to everybody, oh, my son is getting married. That is the first announcement. And therefore, there should be that eager anticipation, followed by a second announcement where the servants will not come and say, oh, the wedding will not take place on this date because everything has been prepared. So there was a first announcement, and then when everything's prepared, then there's a second announcement. They were prepared then. There was a first invitation, and their second invitation that they refused. Why? I think this is the human condition, that sometimes, just like the friends of this king, what they are doing is more important, the invitation to attend the wedding. That there are more important things, my business and my farm and my time is more important than me attending your wedding. That is the insult that they communicated to the king. The refusal to attend, to take part in this joyous occasion of this celebration of the king's son. Isn't that what prevents us as well to experience the joy of being in the Lord? Maybe they felt, ah, you are disrupting, I have business schedules, I could not attend your wedding. Or my farm is more important than your wedding. And I think that is what's preventing us from seeing the joy that is being offered us, because all of a sudden we are focused on how much more that we have that is more important than being with you. This is the human condition brought about by sinfulness, that me, myself, is more important. And this is what hinders us for accepting this wonderful invitation. Invitation to be in the wedding feast is to experience the joy of this wonderful fellowship, good food and wine, and the sharing of stories, right? What is being offered in the wedding banquet is this experience of joy. And yet when we reflect in our lives, there could be difficult moments. Even today, at this very moment, I have five friends who has asked for my prayers because they're faced with cancer. One of them, at this very moment, is now in the hospital. The wife has signed the do not resuscitate, do not intubate. How can I express joy to her? I have a deacon classmate who is based in the Big Island. His parents contracted COVID. His father died, and now his mother is wanting to say goodbye to all of them, to join his dad. Do you know how difficult that is for me to be with my brother Deacon? What can I say? How can I speak about joy? We must realize that joy is not necessarily the absence of suffering. Joy is not necessarily the absence of suffering, but rather joy is in the presence of God. And so when you have friends who are in difficult moments, it will be very difficult for us to say, be joyful, because we associate joyfulness with that cool, jovial, uplifting spirit. But since joy is being in the presence of God, when people are suffering and are in pain, you could still communicate joy by rephrasing your word. Rather than saying, be joyful to one who is suffering, we could say, the peace of Christ be with you in these difficult moments. In your suffering, let the presence of Christ be with you. Do you know how consoling that is for one who are in deep pain, one who is suffering? It is that glass of water that you are giving to this very thirsty person who is in pain. And that is the invitation for us to have this wonderful relationship, a joyful relationship, because this is in the context of God is present in our ups and downs, in our difficult moments and our triumphant moments. Emmanuel, God is with us. And in suffering, God suffers with us. This is the most profound message of the Incarnation. That in my cross, in my suffering, in my tears, Jesus is crying as well. Jesus is sharing my pain, because in this difficulty, God is with us. This is the presence of God made available, no matter what. And that's why the greatest punishment that one can receive is to realize that there are more important things and miss the opportunity to have this joy of being present with the Lord. That, I think, is the most difficult when at the end of the day, because of our exercise of freedom, we want to say to the Lord, I don't love you, I don't care, I don't want to be in a joyful relationship with you. Eventually, we are the one who would feel we've isolated ourselves. We have missed this wonderful opportunity to say yes to this invitation. And in this parable of this wedding, we discover that the invitation in this joyful relationship is by God's grace. Those who attended the wedding have no way to return the favor to the king, right? Good and bad alike, they were all invited. And the only reason they were invited is because of the king's generous love. It is this generosity, it is this grace that is available for us to accept this wonderful invitation. And unfortunately, to accept this grace, to say yes to the invitation, requires for us to have adornments. And that is why we continue on that gospel verse. There was somebody who seems to be not in a wedding garment. Now, can you expect a downtrodden, the poor, who is attending a wedding to be wearing a wedding garment, right? But maybe it is what we people have missed. Because for me, for you, to experience this joy, to say yes to God's grace, we need the garment of Christ. And that's why Paul said, put on Christ. It's when we have the garment of faith. It's when we have the garment of reverence. It's when we have the garment of solitude with the Lord that we will see Him present in our lives. This is what we need. And that in this joyful occasion, we have these garments, Jesus Christ Himself. And in this joyful occasion of this wedding, this is available for us every Sunday and every time we go to the Eucharist. The Eucharist is a preview of this joyful wedding celebration. That's why the Eucharist is a thanksgiving. If I'm to ask you, why do you go to church? What did you miss when we had to do it online? We all reflect the journey from our homes to the church requires first and foremost a change of garments, right? Some of us have to take a bath and put on a difference, and we have to dress up because we're coming to church. We're going to be wearing the clothes that we wear when we did the gardening or the laundry back home, right? So that movement, first, is putting on a new garment, being ready. Second, is taking the car from your home to the church, because that is communicating that we are pilgrims on earth, that we are traveling. And finally, we are here in the church. Yes, our homes is also a church. That is an experience of God present in the home, but in a special, unique way. The church as the house of God gives us a different meaning, right? When we come to church, all of a sudden, what happens? We have that sensation, that feeling of we wanted to pray because we are in the presence of God. You did not come to the church and discover here a living room, a dirty kitchen, a television, right, for watching the latest. No, we have the pews and the altar. Because this is the church, the house of God. This is telling us, this experience of the Eucharist is a preview of that wedding feast in heaven. That joyful celebration when we are able to say, glory to God in the highest. When we are able to say, holy, holy, holy. Isn't that a wonderful preview of our experience in heaven? Each Sunday should be an exciting time for us. Each is an opportunity for us to experience the joy in the wedding feast. The Eucharist is made available for us. Our responsorial song says, I shall live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. After going to Mass, this should be our resolution. That our calling, our ultimate goal, our purpose in life is to be in heaven. Sometimes we may be so distracted with what's happening around in our world that we may miss out this invitation. Let this be a reminder for all of us that we shall live in the house of the Lord all the days of our life. And this house of God is available for us each time we come to church and experience Jesus Christ in the Holy Communion.
Understanding and care. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for the world. May governments recognize the need to work at creating true communities, showing sensitivity and awareness to those who struggle with life's choices through poverty, ill health, failure, and addiction. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for farmers and livestock raisers. May they have abundant harvest to feed the hungry and the thirsty of our world. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for our public servants. May God grant them the humility, the wisdom, the courage to defend all human life. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the members of our communities who are sick and homebound, especially Aaron, Elizabeth Chang, Margaret Weiss, Richard DeConti, our family members, those listed in our parish book of intentions, and those who care for them, may they encounter God's holiness and healing in the midst of their trials. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have died, especially Ronald Chang, Laura Chong, Nervin O'Brien, our family members, parishioners, and all the souls in purgatory, may enjoy the eternal peace and the rest of God's heavenly home. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for the intentions of those in the medical field responsible for public health, doctors, nurses, and all hospital personnel, and those responsible for public safety, especially the firefighters, EMS, police, and military personnel, and for their families worrying at home. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the intentions of Jasper, Carol, Caparaz, and family, and all of us gathered here, those spoken aloud and those in the silence of our hearts. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
God our Father, accept our prayers as we celebrate the great gift of your presence among us. We ask this through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Lift up your hearts.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just. It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For in you we live and move and have our being. And while in this body, we not only experience the daily effects of your care, but even now possess the pledge of life eternal. For having received the first fruits of the Spirit, through whom you raised up Jesus from the dead, we hope for an everlasting share in the Paschal mystery. And so with all the angels, we praise you, as in joyful celebration, we acclaim, Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fountain of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, this gift, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for me, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith. When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring birth to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Mary, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her most chaste spouse, with the Blessed Apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and we praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Amen.
and the saviors of man, and formed by divine picture, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but in the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, for live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the risen Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer one another the sign of peace.
powers. As you leave this Eucharistic assembly, take with you the body of Christ, food for the journey, for our sick brothers and sisters, and remind them that our prayers are always with them. Let us pray. We meet your majesty most humbly, O Lord, that as you feed us in the nourishment which comes from the most holy body and blood of your Son, so you make us sharers of his divine nature, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Is the secret of his name.
Volunteers are needed to help disinfect and sanitize the highly touched surfaces inside and in front of our church after the Mass. We appreciate your assistance. We encourage you to give your weekly offertory donation through our online giving system. It is easy and safe. With any inquiries, please call the parish office at 808-734-0396. Mahalo. As a reminder, face masks to cover the mouth and nose must be worn by all at all times during the Mass. Parishioners with respiratory issues are encouraged to please stay home and watch a live streamed or pre-recorded Mass online. You may visit www.catholichawaii.org to see the schedule of live streamed masses from the various parishes in our diocese. There will be a second collection next Sunday, October 17th and 18th, for World Mission Sunday. Please find envelopes for this intention in the pew. Mahalo for your support. Thank you all for coming together to worship as God's family. We look forward to celebrating with you next Saturday and Sunday, and wish all of you a grace-filled, faith-filled, safe and healthy week ahead. As God's stewards, let us all be continually involved in our parish community. Mahalo and have a blessed evening.
Please rise. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace, to love and serve the Lord through one another.
Thanks be to God.